Well, it's a great honor to be here today. I'm looking at the persons who will build tomorrow's society, but I already now see you will have a problem because you don't have any women in class. So I suggest that you look for more women because tomorrow's society belongs to both genders. It's very important that you do not interrupt me because then I will lose control over my lectures. So please take a piece of paper and a pen or pencil, put down questions and comments, and then we take them afterwards. Also, please do not blindly accept or believe what I say. You have to act as real students, go into the sources, read for yourselves, and think again, ponder, think more, read more, and then come up with an idea or conclusion for yourself and your loved ones. My intent today is that we are going to have a little bit of fun. It will be a wake-up call for some of you, and it will also lead you into thinking in the area of tomorrow's green, human-friendly technology. So I hope that will be the effect. I will talk about adverse health effects of modern man-made electromagnetic fields, such as from wireless telecommunication, mobile phones, wireless internet, but also power frequent magnetic fields, like from power lines and the utility system serving this particular building here. I will start with a general background, and gentlemen, don't let hard work kill your wife. Let electricity do it. You can read this picture in two ways, and that will reveal for me as a specialist in medicine and psychiatry whether you have a straightforward sense of humor or a so-called sick sense of humor. And of course, when we have introduced and invented and manufactured and sold vacuum cleaners or other gadgets in our society, no company wanted to harm us. But while doing this, one has to also realize that the electromagnetic fields that have been let loose in society may be doing things that we don't control today. And I will show you a few examples so that you don't believe I'm fooling you in any way. I will show the first page of peer review-based scientific publications so you can double check for yourself. Did he really tell the truth or not? Very, very early in the history of electricity, and you know that's a very short history when it comes to commercial applications. Electricity as we know it today is around 120 years of age. But very early, people started to report anecdotally adverse health effects. When this new form of power supply was introduced into society, a few people said, I'm not feeling so well. It's something odd with this electricity. And furthermore, when in the 50s amateur DX radio was used, people again started to complain of headaches, tensions, pricking pain in the skin, sharp pain in the ears, tinnitus-like situations. And the idea of what we today call electro-hypersensitivity was actually born. The very first electro-hypersensitive person that is described is actually Nikola Tesla. I guess you have read a lot about him. He was at the same time as Thomas Alva Edison. Today, the most famous electro-hypersensitive person on the planet is Gro Harlem Brundtland, the former head of the World Health Organization and former Prime Minister of Norway. A very, very intelligent woman and still complaining of health effects close to mobile phones, tablets, and similar gadgets. The whole sort of health issue really took off when Nancy Wertheimer, who was an epidemiologist or still is, and the physicist Ed Leeper together studied power lines in Denver, United States. And they went around looking at clusters of childhood leukemia. And they realized and published 1979 a world famous study in Science, the very prestigious scientific journal, about the association between power lines and childhood leukemia. 2001, that led to that the World Health Organization cancer classified power frequent magnetic fields, which, as you know, is a long name for household electricity, as a potential carcinogen connected to childhood leukemia. And that is still valid. And probably the strongest source of such extremely low frequency fields in our society today are mobile phones, tablets, computers, that kind of stuff. They generate extremely high level ELF fields. So the question is, are we actually, without intent, harming each other already as it is? I will then go into the functional impairment, electrohypersensitivity. A functional impairment used to be called a disability, and before that we said handicap. But nowadays we are not allowed to use the words handicap, and also disability is about to disappear. The correct term is functional impairment. And again, you have a tremendously important role here, because every human being during his or her life will many times be functionally impaired, particularly children. And for instance, when I come to the airport at Barcelona, I have been flying from Sweden, I come to Barcelona, I am immediately functionally impaired because I cannot speak Spanish. When you go to Sweden, you will be functionally impaired in Sweden because I guess you cannot talk Swedish. And that is the United Nations definition of functional impairments. And I will talk a little bit more about that. In Sweden, electrohypersensitivity is an officially fully recognized functional impairment. It is not a disease. The persons that has electrohypersensitivity, they are not patients, and they are not treated in any way. And this recognition was by the Swedish government already 15 years ago. At the same time, the Nordic Council of Ministers classified the symptoms of electrohypersensitive persons as an occupationally related symptom-based diagnosis. Practically, this means if this guy here is an electrohypersensitive and he has symptoms like a headache, he can go to a doctor and get aspirins. He can get a paid sick leave to stay at home. But to help him, we need to change the environment. And as you will see, that is a process that is called accessibility measures. I will come back to that. In Sweden, electrohypersensitive people, they have their own handicap organization, the Swedish Association for the Electrohypersensitive. They are included in the Swedish Disability Federation, and they get the governmental subsidy around 200,000 euros per year to be used to propel forward their needs in the Swedish as well as the international society, because as you know, functional impairments do not sense any borders. If a person being electrohypersensitive would leave Spain and go to Germany, he doesn't lose his need for accessibility measures. As a person in a wheelchair going to India doesn't lose the need for a wheelchair, of course. It's the same process all the time. Swedish municipalities follow something that earlier was called the United Nations 22 standard rules, blah, 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 you see here. But 2007, they were upgraded into the UN Convention on Human Rights for Persons with Functional Impairments. On this planet, there are no higher legal levels than a UN convention. That overrules even countries. So if a country is misbehaving, like Sweden, regarding functional impairments, the UN could fine Sweden economic fines, and now we are talking big money. In Sweden, that would equal hundreds of millions of Swedish crowns, about tens of millions of euros per case. So countries don't want to sort of fuck with the UN. They want to stay friends with them all the time because it could cost money otherwise. This is, of course, an expansion of the general human rights for everyone. But when you become handicapped, as we used to say, or functionally impaired, then we get the largest legal umbrella that is on this planet. It's smaller if we are ill, and it's even smaller if we don't have a functional impairment and are healthy. But the functionally impaired have an enormous legal umbrella. You know, when you go to the UN, and you have to do that, and read all the texts, we are talking about hundreds of thousands of pages, and all of them can actually be summarized into one single sentence, namely this: people with a functional impairment, electro hypersensitivity, or any functional impairment, are entitled to have an equal life in a society based on equality. Is Spain an equal society? Your king, how much does he earn every month? No, you see what I mean. But you should aim for it. You will get there eventually. It's the same in Sweden. It's an unequal society, but we will work to get it equal, because the UN says everyone is entitled to have an equal life in a society based on equality. One of them, and maybe the most important principle to achieve this, is the one about complete accessibility. In Sweden, and I've seen it here too, we have the last years built an enormous amount of faced-off sidewalks, kneeling buses, automatic sliding doors, wheelchair ramps, and so on, so on, so on. And also, we are in the process of making the society more accessible for people with, for instance, electro hypersensitivity. And remember that any such measure regarding accessibility, the big winners are not only the person in the wheelchair, it's everyone. I was standing at a place here yesterday evening where you have one of these faced off sidewalks. I didn't see anyone in a wheelchair, but I saw a lot of young men and women on these rolling boards, whatever they are called, you know, and bicycles, women and men with baby prams, shopping carts and whatever. Everyone used it. And that's a very important principle when it comes to accessibility measures. Everyone is a big winner. And as you will see a little bit later on, if we would make Spain accessible for people with electro hypersensitivity, maybe fewer children would get childhood leukemia. Maybe fewer adults will get brain tumors, neurological damages, etc., etc., etc. So the winners could be everyone. Also, regarding accessibility, you remember when I come to Barcelona, I cannot speak Spanish, and therefore I need an accessibility measure. And the easiest way in my case is to get a personal assistant. Someone meeting me, helping me, translating when needed, and sort of maneuvering me through the Spanish society. And that can also be important for persons with, for instance, electro hypersensitivity. Remember that no human being is in itself impaired. There are instead shortcomings in the environment that cause the impairment. When I'm in Sweden, I'm not impaired language-wise. I understand Swedish. But in a new environment, suddenly I cannot make myself clear. The same if I go to France, I don't speak French. If I go to Japan, I don't speak Japanese, etc. So it is the environment that should be treated, not the person. It's not an illness not to speak Spanish, right? And in Sweden, we have a lot of very official action plans, for instance, particularly this one that is called the Swedish Action Plan for Persons with Impairments. And here it's in Swedish, you cannot read that, but here it says, and it's an undertitle, which is very important, from patient to citizen. Before, people viewed persons like in wheelchairs as some kind of patients. They are not. They are persons. They are citizens. And that's a very big shift. And it's again dependent on the United Nations work on this. That means in itself to force a person to quit one's employment or to move from one's home is a serious legal violation. In Sweden, the authority responsible for discrimination has urged anyone being electrohypersensitive, feeling they are discriminated, to immediately file an official complaint. And if it's not enough in Sweden, there is an authority in the European Union, and if that isn't enough, there is a similar authority within the European Union. United Nations. And the same goes for children or students like you. You are not allowed to discriminate them from their educational rights, never. You know, I work at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden, at the Department of Neuroscience, and I teach medical doctors and dental doctors and so on. We have had students being electrohypersensitive. And by making their educational environment accessible, they could fulfill all the requirements to become a medical doctor. And we just had to do it. Also, I have worked for a few years at the Royal Institute of Technology. You know, the Karolinska Institute is very famous because we give out the Nobel Prize in medicine or physiology. The Royal Institute of Technology does the same, but for the Nobel Prizes in chemistry and physics. So these are very prestigious places, and they have, of course, to work along the very same lines. So, actually, when it comes to functional impairments, such as electrohypersensitivity, it's so easy. They should just enjoy their human rights, nothing less and nothing more. That's it. When I give lectures, sometimes someone in the audience sits and thinks, no, I don't agree. But just think for a moment, if your loved ones have electrohypersensitivity, what would you then want from your country? And I've said, quoting, or should we say misquoting, John F. Kennedy, do not ask what you can do for your country, ask instead what your country can do for you. Do you see that there is a printing mistake here? I made a mistake. It shouldn't be can do, but shall do. The UN Convention overrides governments and parliaments and stuff like that. We just have to make the society completely accessible. And you are on the edge to do it. And your brilliant brains will think out tomorrow's human-friendly green technology, and you will revolutionize the entire world. Spain will be richer than ever. Don't forget, you're already the second largest language in the world. You are larger than English. And tomorrow, there will be no Swedish Ericsson or Finnish Nokias or American Motorolas. They will all be Spanish, whatever they are called here, you know. And you will be the CEO and he will be your secretary or vice versa, you never know. I will also talk a little bit about science, because science have investigated persons with this functional impairment. And very early I started, and you have to remember, now we are back in the 1980s. The first cases actually were reported from Norway and United States, but soon people popped up in other countries like Sweden too. And we started to take skin biopsies. And when we take skin biopsies, we can make very thin sections, treat them in various ways to reveal various cell types and or molecules. And we can look at it in different types of microscopes. And this is from fluorescence microscopy. We can stain the cells so they glow when we illuminate them. And what you see here on each picture is the upper portion of the human skin called the epidermis. And this is further down called dermis. The same here, epidermis and dermis. When we did these studies, I had a number of pictures on a table, and a colleague to me, knowing nothing what we were doing, came into the room and he said, "Wow, you are looking at some immune compromised patients, are you not?" "How could you say that?" I said. "Well, this cell type called the dendritic cells in the skin, which are the outermost portion of your immune system, always watching out around the universe what's going on. They should be just a few. There are not so many that are needed. But you have an enormous amount. The immune system is activated." And to make a long story short, I didn't understand that because I was an amateur at the part at that time. But later on, other scientists have shown that when we use electromagnetic fields like from a mobile phone and expose the human skin or other animals or other parts of the body, you will have a general activation of the immune system. It will be stimulated and it will work to keep this extra energy outside of the body, but it will deteriorate and collapse and the activity will dramatically go down. In countries like Sweden, we see an enormous increase in various immune system related diseases, for instance, allergies, asthma, and other oversensitivities. When we talk about children up to the age of 14 in Sweden, more than 50% are immunocompromised. They have allergies, asthmas, or food sensitivities or stuff like that. When I was a kid, it was hardly even possible to find a child with such problems in Sweden. So something is odd. And I'm not saying that this is the final and only answer, but as a scientist, I'm impressed with what I see, of course. Furthermore, when we exposed these persons, these cells that you see up here before exposure, after exposure, they are completely gone. And you know, I was so amateuristic, so I didn't trust my coworkers. So I said to my coworkers, "No way, you must have done something wrong. Go back to the laboratory and remake these staining experiments." So they did, but the result was the same. Had I not been such a bloody amateur, I would have known that in Sweden, you know, in Sweden, it looks like this now, nearly all day round. It's very dark, it's very cold, and it's not nice at all, you know. And Swedes, they go indoors and they sit there watching television, whatever they do. But in the spring, the sun will return. And then Swedes run out and they stand in the sun, it's so lovely, it's so lovely. And then this will happen. Because the cells, they sense that something has changed. There is an environmental exposure. So the cells, they go deep into the body, like the lymph nodes and other immune system organs. And they tell these organs, "Okay, here we go again. Now he or she is standing out in the most dangerous radiation source there is, namely the sun." And as an answer, there will go signals to the skin saying, "Build pigment, build pigment." And you get the post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, or a sunburn or suntan. But that's a reaction to sunlight. So here, we don't expose them to any sun. They have been exposed to a computer screen. Actually, it was a household television set. And still the cells reacted as if they would have if we were outdoors in the sun. So very early, these are from the 80s, very early the idea was formed that this is some kind of radiation damage. So that has been a working hypothesis. We also looked, and you see again, epidermis and dermis. These are normal, healthy volunteers. One example. This is one example from a person with electrohypersensitivity. And I don't think you need to be a scientist to realize, wow, this cell type, and now there is another cell type, namely so-called mast cells. They have nothing to do with telecom masts. It's a German name saying that they are big cells. And you see the number of these white things here, each such being a cell, has increased dramatically. They are bigger, they look more shiny, and they lie more superficially. And if you go to textbooks, this is the classical textbook image of a person that has been subjected to a very strong ultraviolet light, X-ray, or radioactivity, like gamma radiation. So the workers at Fukushima and Chernobyl, they looked like this. But again, we have not given them any X-rays or any radioactive isotopes. They have just come from the street claiming to be electro-hypersensitive. And there is a dramatic difference in between. By the way, all of these images and data and so on, they are of course published if you want to read about it. A journalist in Sweden, Åsa Moberg, she made a list 1994 in the biggest tabloid, Aftonbladet, about the most common symptoms. And it's very interesting because if I back one page, all these symptoms can be explained by this cell type, the mast cell, and its content of the classical marker histamine. When you get asthma or allergic reactions or other forms of oversensitivities, then there is a release from these cells of histamine and other molecules. And all of these symptoms can be explained by one cell type and one molecule. And when you are going to develop tomorrow's human-friendly technique, it's good to have this list in front of you. And also to think, how should we be able not to stimulate these cells to release this histamine molecule? And histamine is, of course, central when we go to allergies, asthma, and oversensitivities. If you only look on C and D, we made a very simple experiment. In Sweden, students, they want to have money. So we can use medical and dental students to do various tests. Some pretty painful, I would say. Then they get a little bit more payment. Here, it was a very simple experiment. We just took young men and women, put them against ordinary household computer screens and ordinary household television sets with their back approximately 40 centimeters from it. We took skin biopsies of the skin before, during, and after the exposure. And the only thing the student should do would be to report if they felt something. You remember this list? Did they feel like a dry mouth or unusual thirst, headaches, depression, unusual fatigue, or anything similar? No one reported any sensations at all. A few students said it was pretty boring to sit with their backs for 8 hours against these computer screens and television sets. But nothing else than that. Then, when we looked in the microscope, this is an example from the same person. Before the experiment starts, you see the epidermis, the dermis, each dot being a mast cell showing its content of one of these marker molecules. After 2 hours, the skin has reacted without the person feeling anything, as if we would have put them close to radioactive isotopes like plutonium, uranium, radium, or close to X-ray machines and rays, or in strong ultraviolet light. But we didn't. We just put them with their backs to these funny computer screens and funny television sets. And still the skin reacted as if there was a radiation damage. You see, you have a lot to do in your future careers, you know, to mend all these mistakes. you know, in all types of science, replications are key, and also independent replications and other models. And I was, of course, very happy to find that one of Australia's foremost cell biologists had done experiments where he took cell cultures, you know, small plastic vials where you can keep cells growing, and then he exposed them to the GSM frequency at that time in Australia, and then he looked on these mast cells again, and this is a particular cell line called HMC1, and they were then microwave exposed to mobile telephony. And these cells reacted as if they would have been hit by nickel or pollen or rubber or something. A classical allergic reaction. And then sometimes, you know, people say, well, Ulle, you cannot show a single published paper. You need to show replications to see that it was just not coincidence that they found this. But this is the replication. The first study that was before that. So this is the replication. And it's interesting to note this. It's below levels where heat is involved, what we call thermal levels. So this is a non-thermal response. And you know, for me, in biomedicine, nearly all the things we do in our life, all your thoughts, wishes, aspirations, when you study and so on, they are not thermal level events, they are non-thermal. They can only be understood in Brownian molecular movements and stuff like this. But you cannot measure any heating of the body. It's not the fever that is going on. I have another colleague, Hajime Kimata in Japan, a very good allergologist. He studies allergies. He took patients with atopic eczema, exposed these eczemas in the skin, and from mobile telephony, you see here, microwave radiation from mobile phones. And then the eczemas got worse. And he can even monitor that in blood samples, because when these molecules increase in blood, that means that eczema is worse. And these molecules are substance P and vasoactive intestinal polypeptide. I got very excited. So I called Hajime and I told him, drop whatever you are doing, come to me at the Karolinska Institute, we need to do more studies. But you know, Hajime being a typical Japanese doctor, he said, I cannot do, must work, boss, no leave, and so on, you know. And I was so happy because we didn't have any money. What the hell should he have done in Stockholm? Sightseeing for a few days and going back, or what should he have done? We couldn't have him coming. And I kind of forgot that when I got excited. So I was happy he didn't. After it, he has done some other studies that are extremely interesting. So if I would have a Nobel Forum conference, he would definitely be one of the speakers. You know, early when persons reported, and I must give it to you, you know, I've never met like a physicist or a person in technology that has doubted persons' beliefs. The doubt was always from my side, from the medical side. You are very different. You always see an opportunity to invent something new, start a spin-off company and earn money. Medical doctors, they are not like that. They often look down on people from their high positions or what they believe are high positions. And that happened here too. When women and men in Sweden started to report skin problems, skin rashes and so on, in front of, you see these big computer screens that were used at that time, cathode ray tubes, the doctors didn't believe them. They said, no, that's just postmenopausal women, you know, they are, and so on. But then men appeared, so then that explanation couldn't hold water. So then they say, well, it's people with a low education, they're afraid of these new computers, they don't know how they work and so on, you know. And then there were like professors, lawyers, doctors, and so on with very high education. And then people say, oh, we meant the opposite. It's actually the persons with high education because they want so much. And these computers, they work so slowly and the paper get jammed in the printer and whatever. And therefore they get stressed. And people talked about imagination, Pavlovian conditioning, even mass media driven psychoses, when newspapers and radio and television was doing interviews and programs about electrohypersensitivity, then these stupid citizens, you know, they sat there and, well, maybe I'm a little bit ill too, I'm probably also electrohypersensitive and so on. And the funny thing with these explanations, the persons behind these had never ever met a single person with electrohypersensitivity. You know, it's like when we say that all Finns carry knives. All Roms, gypsies, they steal. And all Spanish people, they dance flamenco and say caramba. No, they don't. You sit still. You don't do that. These are complete misunderstandings and misconceptions. When it comes to science, you know, it's so easy to solve such questions. But it took some time before we got the possible, the money we needed for these kind of experiments. So we tried then to see, could it be electromagnetic fields, allergies, light sensitivity, chemical factors, or was it some kind of psychological thing? They were imagining this, they were watching TV and so on. And the simple way to solve that is to use rats. Rats do not watch television, they do not listen to radio, they don't read newspapers, and still they get damaged in the very same way as the persons with electrohypersensitivity have claimed. So all these explanations, they completely vanished. And I still am surprised over my colleagues that they were so quick to go to such extreme measures to slander and ridicule the persons that were in need of help. I do hope that you will never ever do something similar. And as I say, I never met the physicist and I never met anyone in technology who has even tried, but don't go there. Well, since time is short, I don't want to keep you up. You know, in Sweden, it's interesting, this time of the day, we have eaten dinner for a long time ago. We have put the children to sleep, the dog, the goldfish, and the cat as well. And we're about to go to sleep, actually. So I don't want to keep you up too long. I will talk about something that is within the European Union, namely the precautionary principle. And you see, I have big initial letters because it's not many, it's just one principle within the European Court of Law. That applies, by the way, to Spain as well. And I will mention some reports and agreements and so on, which I have been honored to co-author together with colleagues. You know, wireless telecommunication has been an extremely sweet piece of candy for Sweden and for Finland, Nokia Consumer Electronics, Sweden Ericsson Telecommunications. But you know, by the way, I love candy. I mean, I've been going around in Matara looking for candy. You don't have very much here, I must say. Some candy, some chocolate, but not very much. Not like in Sweden, you know, we have billions of tons of candy there. And but you know, when you eat candy, you sit there in Sweden in darkness by the television, and you are depressed, of course, because all Swedes are depressed. Dull, boring. It's a little bit too much. It's too sweet. You feel that maybe I should stop. And that happened here too, because very early scientists and thinkers and so on, like myself, reacted to that something was fishy. It was just too good to be true. And I started to write very early commentaries. You know, Sweden is a democracy like Spain, so we are allowed to do whatever we want to, including writing in tabloids, newspapers, participating in radio, television, etc., and speaking out. And so I did. And this is from September 17, 1995. You were not even born then, I guess, you know, so it's a long time ago. And I wrote a commentary or debate article who says, how dangerous are mobile phones? And in the text, I asked a few questions. Questions that still lack answers, oddly enough. Very simple questions. Recently, when I gave a lecture in Sweden, there was a woman in the audience who said, oh, sorry, so I must ask something. Who is that guy? She didn't even recognize me. That is, of course, a young Olle Johansson. This is not me. And this is not my car. That's the kind of car you will buy because you will earn money, you know. And the debate editor, Jan Frimansson, he thought that, dull and boring Swedish text, you know, we must enlighten it a little bit. So he put this picture without asking me even. And he also wrote what it says here. This 80s juppie is dead, but did he die of lack of money, or was it from the dangerous radiation from mobile phones? And people laughed and said, oh, you cannot die from microwaves from mobile telephony. But this Frimansson, he must have had an extra brain, because it turned out he was a prophet. This is exactly what happens when you irradiate, for instance, rats. Their lifespan is shortened. In layman terms, they die earlier than expected because they have been irradiated. That's a thesis from Belgium, a very interesting one, a doctoral thesis. So we shouldn't laugh when we read things, we should instead investigate that. I coined very early, and now you were definitely not born. 1983, I said, this is the largest full-scale experiment ever. What happens when we, 24 hours around the clock, wherever we are, allow ourselves and our children to be used as guinea pigs, whole body irradiated for the rest of our lives? And I have kept on. 1989, 95, 98, 2000, 2001, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, blah, blah. And now we are at 2015. And I repeated myself. Trust me, I'm tired. I have gone on and on and on and on, ranting about this, on, on, on. No one answers what happens. No, I'm kidding. There are persons and organizations that have answered. You know, in English, we have an expression said, follow the money. There are some organizations, corporations, etc., that have answered this question in a very telling way. And now we must go to the area of law and liability and responsibility. Some levels have moved away. They have left the ship on which you are sailing. Among them are the operators, the manufacturers. They do not take any form of responsibility. And don't think this is hidden. This is completely out in the open. All the world's insurance companies, they have lists for things they do not insure or reassure. You know, they can buy risks in between. But there are some things they don't assure or reassure. Among them are health effects of electromagnetic fields. Radiation protection authorities have stepped back. And the World Health Organization, by cancer classifying both power frequent magnetic fields as well as radio frequent signals, have abandoned ship. So if you think you are protected, just forget it. You are as naked as newborn babies. There is no way to go to your insurance company and say, hey, you know, I got the brain tumor, so I want to have some compensation. No. Because they will say, well, sorry, we have actually written it clearly that we don't take any responsibility. And I was at the conference in London 2004. There were a lot of barristers and lawyers and stuff like that from these different companies, including Lloyd's UK and Reassurance in Switzerland. And they all said in unison, for us, it's not the question if there is a risk. The question is only who is going to pay in the future, and we will not do it. Swedish newspapers have reported about this for about 15 years. No Swede, apart from me, seems to have read it. So the only buoy, you know, you can put a buoy around yourself when you're swimming, left is your own government and parliament. And I do hope they have a lot of money, because it could be quite a dramatic bill in the future. So maybe, you know, in Sweden, we have, since it's so boring and dull in Sweden, we have to invent things to do. And each year, we have the Christmas gift of the year. And 1994, this was the Christmas gift of the year. Maybe that was particularly stupid to give to this newborn baby. Some people, they are more active. You know, in Sweden, we are very sort of silent, and we don't do very much and so on. But in the Northern Ireland, they are much more active. And this is from March 8, 2003. The story goes, the municipality announced that they would erect a 250-meter mast construction close to school. The parents with the children at the school said, no, we don't want that. But the municipality still built the mast. Then the parents got pissed, and they went to the hardware store and bought one of these metal filing things and a chain, and then they took a Land Rover and just tipped the thing over. It fell right down. And then they wrote, someone did, a very famous letter to the municipality office, saying that if you ever build this mast again, we will kill you. And you know, in the Northern Ireland, that means Ulster Union or IRA. So the municipality didn't build it, actually. That's not the way we should do it. We should have a representative democracy. We should decide together what kind of risks should we subject children to, for instance. But they got really angry there, so it ended in that way. But when we talk about risks, probably the most scary, and not probably, the most scary risk is the fact, and that has been proven over and over again, that these electromagnetic fields of mobile telephony and similar, they are genotoxic, meaning that they damage the DNA molecules. And the world societies have decided that, for instance, if a food item or a pharmaceutical drug during development shows signs of genotoxicity, it is not allowed to be further developed, manufactured, or sold, because it's a nightmare to let loose a genotoxic effect in the population, including animals, plants, bacteria, etc. So no way, you cannot do that. But here you can do that. And it has been proven and proven and proven, and no one seems to react to this fact. And here we have reached ridiculously high numbers of replications. And the question is, if I point at Mataró on a map and say it's Mataró, how many times do I have to do that before someone believes me? One such replication is this one. This is a very simple type of assay. You can take the DNA molecules from cells, and you have a so-called sham exposure where you don't do anything to it. And then you have an electrophoretic application, and you get this kind of round sunshine type image. If you damage the DNA by using, for instance, gamma irradiation for radioactivity, and this equals 1,600 chest x-rays. No patient in the world has received 1,600 chest x-rays, but it's the equivalent of it. Then you get a tail, because there are small, small fragments that are formed. And therefore, this is called the comet tail assay, or comet assay. And funny enough, if you expose the same type of cells for 24 hours at a so-called specific absorption rate value of 1.3 watts per kilogram, and you are supposed to, in Spain, to withstand 2 watts per kilogram. So this is should be safe. You get exactly the same image as here. You know, I don't know what you are doing in nighttime, but I could wake up in Sweden and really feeling something is wrong. And then I think about this, for instance. And the interesting part with this particular image, it's from a huge study called the Reflex Study. The money that went into the Reflex Study is from the telecom industry, because they wanted to disprove this effect. But when the double-blind codings were opened, it turned out that they had actually proved the thing they didn't want to prove. Do you think the industry went to bizarre length to stop the publication of this study? Yes, but they couldn't. After 2 years, it is published and out in the public domain. And the funny thing is that, or should we say, not so funny thing, when you start reading, and this is a very old picture from 1998, and since then there has been thousands and thousands of new reports, you see that you don't need 2 watts per kilogram to do things to cells. You can decrease eating and drinking, you can change calcium fluxes, you can have the effects on DNA, EEG brain signals are altered, blood-brain barrier leakages occur, and you have cell cycle and cell proliferation alterations 100,000 times below the level you are supposed to feel safe in. And today, you know, you could probably make a list of at least 1,000 papers only showing these kind of under 2 watts per kilogram effects. So if you felt safe when you came here, when you go home, you will not feel safe, I could tell you. I said that people in general didn't really respond to my question when I was ranting on about what will happen when we expose each other. But some has, and this is an example. In Italy, there is a small town called Benevento, outside of Naples. And the municipality office said, wow, this is so very important. So we will pay for a conference with the rooms, the paperwork, the tickets, the hotels, everything, to bring the foremost 30 experts in the world. Well, sorry, the 29 and then myself, also, you know. But the very best scientists, they were invited there. And we had a conference called the Precautionary Electromagnetic Field Approach, Rationality, Legislation and Implementation, talking a lot about the legal point of view. How should society deal with this? I said that we need to compile a resolution and we need to publish that in a peer-review-based scientific journal, and so we did. And I will not read the whole resolution, but it contains bullet points like this one. We need to put together all the relevant scientific literature and to give it to people that are politicians, civil servants, to citizens, to anyone that wants to read it and make up their own mind about this. Also to people in technology, industry, etc. Also, we said that arguments that weak electromagnetic fields cannot affect biological systems do not represent the current spectrum of scientific opinion. And remember, this is 2006 we are doing this, so it's quite a few years ago. The precautionary principle must be used. We must inform the population of the potential risks. We must limit cell phone and cordless phone use by young children and teenagers. You see, by 2006, there were no tablets, e-readers available. People just had these gadgets. And we said we must ban telecom companies from marketing to them, to the young ones. Sometimes, you know, people say to me, oh, it's like Sancho Panza and Don Quixote. You are fighting the big windmills. You can never change this, you know. Maybe so, but this is a moral and ethical obligation to work at the Karolinska Institute being paid by taxpayers' money. That can never be misunderstood. And I don't want to die go to the pearly gates and meet Saint Peter, and he says, Olle, why didn't you tell people you knew about this? I want him to say instead, you did as good as you could. It wasn't enough, but you did as good as you could. Always remember that. You know, in technology, there are few things produced every year that do not harm human beings, animals, plants, bacteria, etc. There are always, nearly always, side effects. Look around in the society and you will see a multitude of such examples. Things are fun, they are good, they will make your life easier, but they will do things that are not as good. And do not put yourself into the situation as Oppenheimer and Einstein, who regretted for the rest of their lives that they were part of the production of the atomic bomb. Well, you know, coming back to Sweden again, I don't know how it is here, but in Sweden, if someone says, shouldn't we have a party? No one says, oh, we will help you. Everyone just leaves the room and, okay, I have to do it. And that was the same here. We said that we needed to compile all the information of relevance. No one popped up and said, we can help you. We can give you resources and so on. We didn't even have a pencil or an eraser, not a single piece of paper. We had to work in evenings and in weekends, in midsummer and Christmas, etc. And after 9 months of hard work, I said, no more. We just cannot continue like this. But then we had put together approximately 2,000 scientific publications and written approximately 600 pages. And here you see Cindy Sage, who is the secretary in this bioinitiative working group. The report was finalized August 31st, 2007, and it's called the Rationale for a Biologically Based Public Exposure Standard for Electromagnetic Fields in the ELF and RF Range. We sit here at a restaurant at the Karolinska Institute, and do you see that there is a Nobel Prize winner in the background? Can you see who that is? In medicine, a Nobel Prize winner in medicine. You see him? Here, it's the arm of Bengt Samuelsson. Sometimes you need to know things before making up your mind, you know. So this is a typical example of that. The other guys, they're also important, but not as important as he is. You know, when you write a book on 600 pages, you need to be as good as Dostoevsky for anyone to read it. And we were not. I realized August 31st, 2007, no one is going to read this. It was just a complete waste of time. But I was wrong. 1 year later on, September 4, 2008, the European Parliament had read it. And not only read it, they had understood every single letter in it. And they had voted 522-16 to recommend tighter safety standards for cell phones. And I quote, the limits on exposure to electromagnetic fields which have been set for a general public are obsolete. I don't know about your English knowledge here, but the word obsolete in English is very strong. If you say obsolete, then you really mean it. It's out of date. It doesn't protect in any way. And I was impressed, Jesus Christ. And they said we have to come up with new exposure guidelines for the general public. And I thought, wow, the European Parliament is going to call us, give us resources, and we will do the job for them. And we were pretty far ahead already. But then another player appeared. The telecom industry said, this is very good. We agree. We must investigate the public exposure standards. But this bioinitiative working group, no, they cannot do it. But we, the industry, we will do it. And so they did. And to your great surprise, they came up with the conclusion that nothing needed to be changed. This is the way the European Parliament works. I was a little bit depressed, I must say, after that. When it was published, August 31st, 2007, I went home, I came back the day after. In my computer, there were already three more papers being published overnight, which should have been part of the BioNIS2 report. And therefore, we have updated 2012 and 2014, and today it's in the order of 5,000 scientific references and approximately 2,000 pages of text, all pointing in the same direction that these electromagnetic fields are not entirely good for you. On the contrary. And I will quickly show you some examples. If you allow male sperm cells to be exposed from microwaves from telecommunication, they don't like it. They will decrease in number, they will decrease in motility, viability, and their normal morphology will change. In Europe, for instance, today, when we talk about male sperm cells and their quality, is it going like this, or like this? It's going like this. So something is going on. I'm not saying that this is the final answer, but if I was responsible for public health in Spain, in France, Italy, or Sweden, I would be terrified to notice that just by being exposed to microwaves from telecommunication, you will end up in this result. Others have studied fertility, and to transfer this publication in the industry-driven journal Bioelectromagnetics, important to remember, these Greek scientists concluded that after five generations, we may run a risk of complete infertility. That means in Mataró that your grand-grand-grand-grand-grandchildren, approximately 150 to 200 years time from now, cannot make babies any longer because of something you did 2015 or even before that. And then it's very, very too late to call back and say, hey, could you please wait a little bit? I think we have an effect here which is not so good. So hopefully all of these papers are wrong. I would love to come to St. Peter and he says, you did as good as you could, but you were wrong. That would be the best. It would be the best that all of these studies are wrong. Namely, it is safe. But then approximately 25,000 peer-review-based scientific papers need to be wrong at the same time. And that has never, ever happened before. So the probability is pretty nil, I would say. If you look on fetuses in mother's tummy or newly born babies and expose them to mobile telephony, then their heart rate will be quicker and each heartbeat will be more shallow. In layman terms, the baby is stressed. When I ask parents, mothers and fathers, if they want to stress their babies, no one says, yeah, that's what I want to do. No one does that. They get horrified. It's often quite common that people get angry when I lecture, not at me, but at their health authorities, governments, and parliaments who hasn't informed them about all of this. And of course, it's strange. I don't know for Spain, but in Sweden, parents are forced to send their small children to wireless schools where they're exposed to something the World Health Organization May 31st, 2011, cancer classified. That's just very odd. And when parents find out about that, they do get pissed, I could tell you. Tomato plants in France should not buy, own, and use mobile phones. This is actually a base station study, so it's just the ambient surrounding exposure. And here it's time to ask yourself, if we only look on the third generation mobile telephony, not the second, not the 4G, not power lines, not computers, not e-read, nothing like only 3G, how much more radiation are you affected by today than for 10 years ago compared to natural background? Is it twice as much? Three times? Four times? Five times? An old man at the lecture once said, no, it's much more. It's 100 times more. But he was wrong. It's a quintillion times more. That's a 1 with 18 zeros compared to natural background. You know, biological systems are extremely sensitive to change. We can detect the most minuscule changes. To talk about something that is 1 and 18 zeros times higher than natural background, then we must use words like astronomical, biblical exposure levels. So it would be surprising if, for instance, plants doesn't react to this. And when these French scientists did these experiments, it's very, very well carried out and very well controlled and so on, the tomato plants reacted, and I quote Alain Vion, the second author here, he said, you know, it was like we had crushed the tomato plants with a hammer. And when you crush a tomato plant, or you cut flowers, or you cut your grass, these living organisms will react with a damage sequence, including a molecule called calmodulin. They didn't touch the tomato plants, and still, when exposed, they reacted with the same sequence of damaged molecules. So you can wonder, you know, you have such a beautiful landscape here. I've been around looking at all these fantastic animals and plants you have here. You don't see them because you're used to it, but I see them because I'm not used to them. And I always wonder, how do they feel? Do they also send in despair damaged molecules? Are they trying to protect themselves or not? When it comes to yourself, when you expose, for instance, rats to, in this case, the Bluetooth frequency, 2.45 gigahertz, again at levels that you should withstand, 0.6 watts per kilogram is below the 2 watts we were talking about. Rats show retarded learning due to a decrease in concentration capacity and decrease in short-term memory. Well, rats, you say, but boys like yourself, they show the same. In a linguistic test, they did less good when they were double-blindly exposed to microwave exposure from mobile telephony. You know, Sweden, in contrast to Spain, and I'm sorry for that, really, I wish you so much more, but Sweden is extremely rich. We swim in money there. It's only Norway that is richer in the world per capita than Sweden. And that means that our schools are the most computerized schools in the world. Each pupil, regardless of age, it could be a preschool, 5-year-old, they have like a mobile phone, a tablet, 2 computers, and a little bit more. So they expose themselves all the time. And the higher they get, the more things they are given by teachers and parents. But still, in these famous PISA tests, which evaluate learning, Swedish students are plummeting, like a skyrocket going downwards. And they are doing less well in math, less well in reading and understanding text. And funny enough, they do less well in internet knowledge, Wi-Fi knowledge, computer handling. So Swedish kids are getting dumber by the minute. And I'm not saying this is the single answer. I'm just saying, if I was the Prime Minister of Sweden, I wouldn't be sleeping too well in the nighttime. Well, we are coming to the end of the lecture, and before we leave this interesting topic, you know, I said that when you have like 600 or 2,000 pages, and if you're not Dostoevsky or Chekhov or Gogol or someone, then you need to maybe make a summary. And we decided to go and meet again, this time outside of Bergen in Norway, at a place called Seletun. We met in November 2009. I will never forget it because it was raining so enormously. So we had, instead of walk, we had to row ourselves in boats to the restaurant and stuff like that. It was really raining. And then we sat down and we discussed for a number of days. After also we worked for months and months with the text. And finally we sent it to an American journal and got it published in 2010. And we then said that low intensity, so-called non-thermal bioeffects and adverse health effects are demonstrated at levels significantly below existing standards. You have seen examples of that in previous slides. And the organizations, and here in Spain, you rely upon this organization. In United States, they have these. And they have public safety limits. They are inadequate and obsolete with respect to prolonged low-intensity exposures. New biological-based public exposure standards are urgently needed to protect public health worldwide, and it's not in the public interest to wait. If you, after this lecture, want to read something, I recommend this Seletun statement. It's only 8 or 9 pages long, so it's very short, but it gives you all the bullet points you need. And that was 2010, and then what? Well, 2011, May 6th, the Council of Europe said, ban mobile phones and wireless networks in schools. I suppose that this university doesn't have anything of this. I guess you listen to the Council of Europe, one of the most important authorities in Europe. Or, May 31st, 2011, the World Health Organization and its cancer organ, the International Association for Research on Cancer, classified all radiofrequent electromagnetic fields as possibly carcinogenic. And remember then, if they had felt it was safe, they could have classified them in the class 4, and that class is for proven non-carcinogenic exposures of substances. But they didn't. They said it should be here. And today I was interviewed by a woman in Florida, United States, over the internet. And one of the questions she asked was, would I be willing to support a reclassification to 2A, which is further up, or even 1, a proven carcinogen? And I said, based upon the science, no, I think this is still enough. But from a moral, ethical point of view, yeah, go to 1. We are talking about toys. These are not life necessities. Life necessities, which you know, are things like clean air, clean water, food you can eat without risk, love, understanding, compassion. Toys can never be life necessities. That's a misconception. And therefore, I would say, yeah, why not? You know, in English you say, better be safe than sorry. The opposite, I wouldn't dream of. Again, coming to St. Peter and he says, why didn't you speak up? You had all this knowledge, all these publications. Why didn't you tell the men in Mataró that very evening? But I did. You got the information. It's up to you to act on it. Someone have acted. In Italy, the Supreme Court, which is the highest level in Italy, it cannot be overruled, has ruled that a mobile phone caused a brain tumor in a patient. October 12, 2012. This year in January 29, France has adopted a very strict law about wireless systems in schools. If this would be a school in France, you would probably not even have anything of this. You would have to do without it, which is a good exercise. It's a little bit, you know, when we train medical students, they are used to these very fancy things, a lot of equipment and so on. And during their training, we take away everything. What can they do with their hands, with their brain and so on? So that's a very important lesson to be learned. And now we are in Catalonia. It's October 2015. And maybe the answer to that question I put, what will happen when we expose ourselves and our kids and so on, Maybe the answer is no more full-scale experimentation. And we need a moratorium to give you time to run whatever you have, your laboratories and offices and so on, sit down, think, and come up with tomorrow's solution regarding a green, human-friendly technology. And to help you a little bit along the lines, I would tell you that you should never believe that mobile phones, wireless internet, and so on are safe. They are not. They interfere with normal brain function, learning and memory, fertility, cancer risks, and have been shown to shatter the DNA in cells. All of this can be found in peer-reviewed scientific journals, but until now has not been in the public domain. So if you want to read, you can read. And I tell you, there is a lot to read out there. Just by interesting yourself for these health effects, you will probably end up with around 25,000 publications. But if you expand to biology in general, including biophysical effects in animals, like, you know, shark attacks and navigation in birds and insects and so on, there will easily be more than 100,000 publications. There's a huge number of studies to be read. And based upon that, you can start asking questions about safety. And as I said before, you here in Spain are supposed to withstand 9 million microwatts per square meter. In the United States, even 10 million microwatts per square meter. And various countries, reports, private persons, and so on, have suggested that it should be lowered, that we shouldn't expose people so very much, and not dogs, not cats, not goldfishes, no plants, bacteria, and so forth. But to the best of my knowledge, there is only one hygienic safety value ever proposed, and I did that. 1997, I said the only way to be safe rather than sorry is to go back to the natural background, and this is the natural background. And if you divide these figures with that, then you have a quintillion times difference. This was proposed in Stockholm at a trade union office. We sat in a room half of this size and with a few people. In that room at that time was one of the strongest opponents to me. And he spoke up when I had presented my idea, and he said, usually I never listen to or trust Olle Johansson, but this time he's 100% right. 1997, and you live in these numbers. Will you sleep well tonight? No, you will not. Do you know why? Because when you are exposed to these kind of electromagnetic fields, like from mobile phones, your nighttime sleep cycle is changed. And you know, it's four stages, stage one, two, three, and four. Number four is very famous because it's called the REM sleep, the rapid eye movement sleep, or dream sleep. You have all your wet dreams. No, not that kind of wet dreams. The wet dreams to be published in Nature, Science, and stuff like that. Few are ever called. But this very year, we are back in Nature Scientific Reports with a study that just was published a few days ago. So we have traveled from that level down and up again. So you will be published, you know, your wet dream will come true. But you will not dream it, because the stage four is completely wiped out when you're exposed to these modern electromagnetic fields. And that is not good, because stage four, it's not only dreaming, it's not only moving your eyes rapidly, that's the only stage when your body, particularly your brain and spinal cord, should repair itself. Sometimes when I look upon society from my position, and you remember I'm a neuroscientist by trade, so I know a little bit about brain, spinal cord, and so on. When I look out, not here in Mataró, but in other parts of the world, I don't see Homo sapiens You remember Homo sapiens? It's the wise man, Homo sapiens. I see another type of species, Homo stupidiensis, the stupid man. And I see so much stupidity, so I cry. I never see giraffes with machine guns. I only see human beings doing bad things to this planet. And I do hope I'm wrong here, that this is no bad at all. It's only good for us. But we will see in the future. You know, it's tremendously nice to come here. I'm sorry I have woke you up. And I do hope I will be able to come back. And if you ever come to the Karolinska Institute or Stockholm or Sweden, please make yourself known, and you can visit like the Nobel Forum or anything like that if you would be interested. Thank you so much. You know, before we take the questions, I have to admit one thing. I'm really lousy with computers. You know, I tried to make half of it a Spanish flag and a half Catalonian flag, not to upset anyone, but the computer refused. It just didn't do it. But behind this flag is a Spanish flag. You have to trust me. So I'm sorry it didn't work out as I thought. You know. But please, questions, and if you want to, you can put on the light in the ceiling so we see each other even better.
Thank you so much for your nice presentation.
Thank you.
It has been very interesting. So now, would you like for some comments, suggestions, and questions?
Each question is worth 10 points on the next exam, so you will be wise to ask a lot of questions now, you know. Yes?
Do you know of any study working on making a new hazard technology?
Oh, that's a very good question. I'm glad you brought that up. You know, I said that Sweden is very rich. Norway is ridiculously rich per capita. But they have a source of income that is not infinite. They calculate that in 50 years' time, the oil runs out, and 120 years' time, the gas. So they are looking to reinvest their enormous wealth into other sectors of society, one of them being human-friendly technology. So I'm very often a guest at different secret meetings, you know, where the industry wants to learn and understand and so on. So they are very much into this. And, you know, I think they are really aiming for something really good. They are also a little bit wondering where this is going to take mankind. And more people do react. But then, you know, I mean, just remember these young men sitting in a garage in California starting what would become later on Microsoft. So it's not only a matter of money, it's a matter of this. Right person, right brains, and so on, that sit down and have a defined endpoint. This is what we want to do. How should we get there? And I know you are already experts on this, really. So don't be sort of blind, looking only at money. Sometimes you need to have other resources and also a good portion of luck, naturally, you know. So hopefully here or in Norway. And there are projects, yes, but I cannot tell you more than I have to kill you.
Okay, more questions?
Don't be shy. You know, we will never meet again, so take a chance.
It is known that the radiation from the, especially mobile phones, do affect our sexual organs. You said the quality of the semen.
And also female egg cells do not like this. And we have done a very interesting experiment. It will take a few minutes to explain it. If you think we take a big table, on it we could build an ant society, small ants that are crawling around. And they will do the work for us. In this big table, they will have one corner where they eat, one corner where they sleep, then they have the toilet in one corner, and their babies, their eggs, in one corner. And then the ants will go in between and doing things. And while ants do that, they are very sort of concentrated and are aiming for the survival of the species. If you put a mobile phone in standby mode under the table in a controlled way, so they don't know they're being exposed, then the ants start to stop more often. And when they stop, they look around. And then they continue, and then they look around. And also, if you instead put the mobile phone under their babies, they will move the babies to the other corner, maybe that where they have the toilet, and they take the toilet and move it on top of the mobile phone. When you take it away, then they will restore these living quarters. They will move the babies back where they belong according to their scheme, which we don't understand how that is really done. So that's a very typical example of how tomorrow's generations are at jeopardy. And when these Greek scientists investigated, that was also, you know, science is always sort of a combination between aim and coincidence. The Greek scientists, Magras and Senos, they got from the Greek state, they said that they had to investigate why people in Greece had a deteriorating public health. And they took a town and used it as a model, and then they went to extreme measures to interview people. Did everyone drink or smoke or drive car or eat chocolate or use carpets or not use carpets and whatever? And eventually they had to conclude that no, they couldn't find a common denominator. Nothing was common in between. And they described themselves how they one afternoon stood on the town square. And you know, like here, Greece is very much hill and valley, up and down, up and down. And for practical reasons, antennas for radio, TV, mobile phones and so on are put on the ridge, the top of this mountain. Because then you can illuminate that town, but also the next town in another valley. And you can have one road and one power cable, etc. And they stood there and could that have interfered with the public health? Strange. And you know, it was more than 2 kilometers away. And then they said, we need to do a controlled experiment. So they took mice and exposed them at a very low exposure level. And they looked on the offspring, and to make a long story short, the first generation, nothing happened. The second, nothing. The third, nothing. The fourth, nothing. At that time, they had a lot of mice, I could tell you, because mice like to do babies. But they looked a fifth time. And then they realized that the fertility had been changed to a near 100% infertility. And the editor of Bioelectromagnetics told me afterward, this was published in 1997, if I can remember correctly, he said that, you know, when an editor gets a manuscript, he makes copies and sends it to experts in the world, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 experts. And they will read it, and anonymously, without revealing who they are, they can say, yeah, good or bad, or, well, it's sort of good and bad, but they need to change a little bit. He got back these referee reports, and he felt that, wow, they had all said, no, this is perfect. They had done an excellent job. You must publish this. But he felt that, no. Being at Bioelectromagnetics, the foremost journal of the telecom industry, he felt that if I publish it, they will kill me. So he did something that some Nobel Prizes have gone through, namely a double referee control. He took 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 new experts and said, you have to read it with a big magnifying glass. Something is fishy here, you know. They read it, and they all said, no, this is perfect. They have not done anything. And he decided he had to publish it. And 1997, he did. So it really shook the world. And it's still shaking the world, at least the world that is paying attention. and the rest of the world is occupied of updating their Facebook profiles. And I cannot do anything about that, you know.
Thank you. Maybe we have time for a couple of questions?
Yes, please. I love questions.
One question? The last question?
Not the last.
Another question.
Yeah, please, go ahead. We have the whole evening.
Let me remember you now.
Yeah, 20 points. Yeah, 20 points.
20
points.
What is the range of mobile phone variation? I mean, if you have a mobile phone in your bag,
yeah,
it will probably, after time, affect your, what I explained you before, what I asked you before. What is the range of
Oh, there is no outer range border. It will continue to travel for infinite number of miles, you know. And but you can change your question a little bit. And I had the same question. You should actually come to me and work with me. Because 1998, at the conference in Göteborg on the west coast of Sweden, the very biggest experts in the world were collected at the I think it was like 4-day conference. And we heard experts talking about various effects I've shown here, you know. And towards the end of the conference, I said to a physicist from the university there, which is a very prestigious one, and I said, when we have heard all these experts telling us about these health effects, if we extrapolate that into hands-free, and we have a cable, how far away do I have to put the mobile phone from the body to be safe? And then this physicist said, well, you know, I'm standing on the podium here and I cannot calculate exactly, but let's see, well, it would be enough with 5 to 10 kilometers. You have to realize that a mobile phone is an extremely strong torch. If you put a mobile phone on the surface of the moon in standby mode, it's just waiting for a call. It's the strongest radio source in the universe seen from planet Earth.
Absolutely amazing.
But what does that tell you? You should. It tells you that the radiation sources in the universe are very weak. And, well, I cannot put on this, maybe I can. And they are this weak. This is the microwave exposure, the background exposure from the universe because of the Big Bang. And all life on the planet has evolved in these levels. And suddenly we are supposed to take this. And of course, for a person in medicine or biology, this is just freaking baloney, you know. I'm just surprised that anyone would allow an exposure increase like this. Just think, I mean, you have such fantastic birds here in Mataró. Have you seen that? No, because you live here, so you don't see them. But I will watch them today. And one of these birds is a special dove. And just imagine that this dove tomorrow morning has decided to increase the voice strength a quintillion times. And then he sings, and then there is no Mataró any longer. Actually, Barcelona disappears at the same time. The sound shock will just make everything into sand here. Forty. Well, come on.
Okay, maybe the last question. Yeah. Now we are discussing. Worried about electromagnetic exposure from microwaves, mobiles, radio radiation, and so on. But I wonder if you have any idea of the future in terms of smart cities. This is another, maybe another continuum. I don't know if you are.
You know, you have to remember that the expression smart cities, as with smartphones and so on, doesn't apply at all to me. The only smartness I see is in brain capacities. I meet very smart persons now and then. Some of them receive Nobel Prizes, and they are very special. And also I see the smartest of them all, and that's all the other species. including plant species, because they are very smart in adaptation to their special portions of biology. Human beings do not impress, and therefore, just the word smart city is what we're talking about. Mankind is facing issues of a magnitude that will melt down Europe, you know. Right now, people in Holland, for instance, are already planning to leave Holland because of the global warming. You can build barriers to a certain height, but then you run out of money, and Holland will be flooded. And they aim to go to Germany, and the Germans don't want that. They have already problems of their own. So you see, in a few decades' time, things will change, making the need for smart cities very, very small. We need smart brains instead. And I have had the great honor not only to meet you, but also to meet in the world some of the greatest kitchen chefs, for instance. I remember particularly one person in Paris. He had got a lot of prizes for his cookery. And I said to him, you know, in Stockholm we have these cook shops. You can buy shiny things, big machines and so on, you know, to put in your kitchen. What kind of machines do you use? Machines? What machines? You know, blah, 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 blah. No, I only have this. And he took up a knife that was about this size with a pretty dirty wooden shaft. That was his machine, but he had this. And I also met some of the best gardeners in the world. And you know, they have like a rake, a spade, and a brain. So don't get impressed by things. Then you are on a loser's track, I would say. Sorry I couldn't support your idea of smart cities. You know. But I know what you mean. And of course, if we would go down that avenue, the exposure levels will be even more dramatically increased. But I think it will solve itself because, you know, Sweden, I said, it's a very rich country, but actually it's not very rich because per capita, I said, per person, and we are only 9 million. So altogether, it's not very much. And already we used 2 nuclear power plants to furnish energy to the wireless system. It's an impossible equation in the long run. We must do something about the costs of the society. So I think a lot of these things will solve itself. And I have had the great honor also to meet the smartest individuals on this planet. Dolphins and whales. And then you see, well, you can do pretty well without smart things as well. But you will solve this. I will retire and I will not do this any longer, but you will solve all of it for me.
I think it's time for concluding. Thank you very much.